Alan, Alan, Bert, Bert, Jim, Bob. The Buzzard Daytime Tango starts today at 2.
Wow.
On Buzzer.
Ladies and gentlemen, Gary Moore.
With us on To Tell the Truth. Our first guest is fortunately a very loyal fan of our show. That's always nice to be able to say. And not only that, but he saw an amazing demonstration on one of our programs a while back. He watched it on the air and he decided that, by golly, he was going to try to learn how to do that particular one-of-a-kind stunt. And what's even more amazing, he did learn how to do it. And we're going to have film today to show you what happened when he actually learned how it was done. We were amazed that it happened here. Now it has happened again. We'll meet him after we have met our sterling panel here on To Tell the Truth. Hey,
Tom Kennedy!
Panel, I was telling the folks that a while back on our show, a good while, in fact, we had a remarkable skier with us. He actually constructed an indoor ski ramp right here so that he could do a gainer flip.
Uh-huh.
Indoors, mind you. And as a special treat for the television audience, he constructed this ramp. Mm. His name was Herman Goldner, and now let's watch him in action. As he appeared on To Tell the Truth on this stage, you'll see me doing the setup. The theory is he's going to come down, go into the air, do a flip, and fortunately land on his feet. Have a little luck. So.
He was good.
Wait for him to get set. Now, let's hold it kind of quiet, please, because, you know, this is difficult circumstances. Lights in his eyes and that sort of business. Okay. You all ready, Herman? All right, Herman. Take it away. That was Herman Goldner. Well, now, can you imagine anybody watching that on television and saying, I'm going to teach myself how to do that? Oh. Well, our first guest did that. He's still around to tell about it, and let's meet him right now.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Glenn Motto.
Number two.
My name is Glenn Motto.
Number three.
My name is Glenn Motto.
And as always, the panel's job is to find out which one of these fearless fellows is indeed Glenn Motto, and here is his story. He says, I, Glenn Motto, watched an acrobatic skier on the To Tell the Truth show. I was determined to learn how he did it. My dad then took me to meet Mr. Goldner, and we became good friends. Herman gave me lots of good pointers, too. And finally, I taught myself how to flip. Watch this film. Here he comes, down the hill. And up on his skis.
Darn good.
Wow.
Gee.
This story continues. I then sent a letter to the To Tell the Truth program telling them my story, and lo and behold, they invited me to be a guest on their program. I must tell you that I sent the letter after I'd entered the North American Ski Championships. There, as the only kid competing against 7 professionals and 10 amateurs, I won the Somersault Championship. Signed, Glenn Motto. And you three gentlemen get comfortable over there, and we'll flip for our sponsors for a bit and be right back. Now then, remember, if you will, that all three of these splendid-looking young gentlemen claim to be Glenn Motto, a boy who watched an acrobatic skier, Herman Golner on a To Tell the Truth program and set out to emulate him. Let's start the question with Kitty Carlisle.
Thank you. Well, good for you, whoever you are, and I'm glad we were helpful. Number one, what is the North American Ski Championships?
It's when you go to a certain ski area.
Where?
Any certain ski area. Oh. It doesn't matter. And they have a contest that you can do a flip on or anything that you want.
And number two, how old were the seven amateurs?
They were all grown-ups.
And all of them all grown-ups?
Yes.
Thank you. Number three, did you have any accidents while you were practicing this feat?
Well, yes, I fell on my back a few times and I broke a ski.
Well, that was better than breaking something on you. Yeah. Number one, where did you find Herman Golner?
At Bromley Mountain.
And number two, where do you live?
I live in Killington, Vermont.
And was he near there? Is Bromley Mountain near there?
Yes.
Number three, are all your family skiers?
Yes.
Number one, did your father win any championships?
No, he didn't.
Number two, you're going to be an Olympic?
I'm sorry, Kitty, to cut you off. We're going down to Tom Kennedy.
All right, number two, how old are you?
I'm 11.
And number three, what kind of releases do you have?
Well, what do you mean by that?
Number one, what comes after the snowplow when you're learning how to ski?
Well, I can't remember the name of it.
Number two, what is a stem Christie?
Stem Christie is where you turn a half a snowplow.
Uh-huh. And which is more fearsome, appearing on this show or doing a flip?
Doing a flip.
Not by much.
But not by much. Number three, what two bones usually break when you break a leg?
Well, your radius and your ulna.
Something like that. Number one, you know what a spiral fracture is?
Spiral fracture, no.
Okay. Number two, do you know what a spiral fracture is?
No. It's when he hits somebody.
Pardon
with
me?
The
call.
No, I do not.
All right. And,
Thank you, Tom. Let's go to Peggy Cass.
A spiral fracture is when he hits somebody with his golf ball.
Good. I just got it.
That was good.
Not very good, but better than nothing. Number three, what's a mogul?
Well, a mogul is a hump in the snow.
Thank you. Thanks. Sorry about that. Number two, what length skis did you use?
For the flip?
Yeah.
3.5 feet.
And say you're going parallel skiing, what length ski do you use?
I'll use about a 4, maybe a little larger.
Thank you. Now, number one, what were your skis made of when you did the flip?
Wooden.
They're wooden. And number two, do you use wooden skis to ski regular skiing? Or?
No, I use fiberglass.
But for the flip, do you use
Yes.
wooden skis?
Yes.
Why?
I just do.
Maybe because they break more often and they're cheaper or something?
What? Yeah, they are cheaper.
Yeah. Now listen, number three, could you ever use this trick if you went into the Olympics? There's no use for it, is there?
No.
Do you ever jump? Do ski jumping?
Well, yes. Not in contests, but for fun I jump, yes.
Thank you, Peggy. Bill Cullen, what's on your mind?
Well, number two, the fact that you wanted to learn to do this trick indicates to me that you're already interested in skiing. How long, number two, have you been skiing?
I started when I was 2.5.
And you are now?
11.
11. Number one, do you have ideas of going on to compete and perhaps aiming toward the Winter Olympics?
Yes, I do.
Number three, have you chosen an event in which you want to specialize as far as Olympic competition?
Well, I think I'll probably go in the slalom.
Uh-huh. Number two, how about you? What do you have in mind for your future?
Yeah, I'd slalom, maybe even racing.
Have you thought about the ski jumping like they do at Bear Mountain where they have the ski jumps, number two?
A little, not really.
Does that not appeal to you?
No.
Number two, I'll stay with you. Who is our number one slalom skier right now?
I think he's Jean-Claude Keeley.
Number one, do you have anyone that you particularly admire as far as the downhill? What's the difference, number one, between downhill and slalom? Oh, it is. Good. Yeah, that's what I thought.
Answers. The bell rings and he doesn't have to answer. And so we're about to mark our ballots over on this side. And, of course, there's only three choices. Logical, right? It's number one, or it's number two, or it's number three. And remember, we pay our team of challengers each $50 and for each wrong vote, and we pay $500 if the whole thing goes down the drain. And Kitty starts, please.
Well, they're all wonderful youngsters, and I know any one of them could have mastered this trick. But I voted for number one.
Got a number one going there. All right, Kitty, and what are we going to do with Tom?
Well, Gary, any skier's got to know what releases are, the toe and heel. If he doesn't know that, he's going to be in big trouble. So that leads out number three. Number one, I think he had trouble with the snowplow, and any skier would know what that is. Number two had all the answers. He impressed me as being the guy.
All righty, in the middle, number two, and Peggy.
Well, I voted for number two. He answered everything very well, but when I never really thought of a Sam Christie as being half a snowplow. I like that explanation, so I voted for him, too.
Paratus and Bill Cullen.
Well, no, I listened very carefully to all the answers these young men gave, and I, because I don't know anything about skiing, I think they were all right. and I voted for number three because he has a flag on his hat.
There's good enough reason. All right. Hey, we're all over the place. The votes are in. Will the real Glenn Motto please stand up? Magnificent team. I want to tell you, those imposters are something else again. Number two, tell us about yourself. What's your real name? What do you do? And what's your skiing experience?
Well, my name is Todd Zwigart. I go to the Lawrence Intermediate School, and I do not ski.
You don't ski at all. He looks like a Norman Rockwell picture of a young skier, doesn't he? Yeah, he looks like he was born on skis. Number three, what is your real name? What do you do?
My name is James Hunt, and I go to the Buckley School in New York City, and I do ski.
And you do ski. Well, Glenn, I can't tell you how proud of you we are, and we're delighted that you got the idea from this show. Say hello to Mr. Goldner for us, and thank you all very much for being with us on To Tell the Truth. Take care. Now, let's meet a lady who sailed around the world.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Maida Barthol.
Number two.
My name is Maida Barthol.
Number three.
My name is Maida Barthol.
And here is the story of Maida Barthol. She says, I, Maida Barthol, sailed in the first homemade American trimaran to ever circumnavigate the globe. The trimaran, a triple-hulled vessel made of marine-grade plywood, was only 32 and a half feet long. In the course of a fantastic adventure that lasted well over 3 years, my husband and I experienced some wild storms. We also saw some lovely sights. Let's take a look at a few pictures that we took along the way. Here is a rice paddy on the island of Bali. We spent 6 months on this lovely island. And this beautiful mountain range was in Cape Town, South Africa. The low-slung clouds make it appear as if the mountains are snow-covered. And we thought that Penryn Island off New Zealand was uninhabited until 20 natives came running toward us, singing of all things, "You Are My Sunshine." This once-in-a-lifetime adventure becomes all the more incredible when you consider the fact that my husband and I had very little previous sailing experience. Signed, Maida Barthol. And ladies, we'll turn you over to the old man of the sea, Captain William Cullen.
I am curious to know how, number three, just how much sailing experience did your husband and you have before this all began?
Very little.
Yeah, but I mean, to what extent? I mean, you know, details.
Well, we built the boat and had roughly a year of sailing experience before.
With the boat you intended. Number one, how did you get the idea, or why did you decide you wanted to sail over the sea yourself, just you two? What were you trying to, you obviously had something in mind.
Well, when we were in college, we knew we were going to get married, and we didn't want to just go right into the grown-up world of working.
Mm-hmm.
And this sounded romantic, so we thought about it, and it eventually panned out.
It is. How's the marriage going, number one?
It's panning out, too.
Number two, what's the rig on your catamaran, the sailing rig?
It's the rig right in front of the mainsail.
I see. Number one, what did you do for navigation? Did one of you navigate, or did you...
No, we all did. There were three of us.
Who was number three? Who was the third party there? That's...
A male partner.
How'd the marriage turn out, number one?
That's why they call it a trimaran. sailing arrangement I've heard in a long time. All right, Kitty, well...
Well, how about the sleeping quarters, number two? I saw a picture of it, and there are three separate sections. Did you each sleep on one separate section?
No, we slept in the center hull. There are the two flotations on the side and then the center hull, and it sleeps four comfortably.
Oh.
More it's tight.
Thank you. Number three, is there any possibility of a trimaran turning over in a bad storm?
There is the possibility.
Number two, did you, when you built this boat, had you been going to college too, as number one said?
Yes.
And you took the trip for the same reason?
Mm-hmm.
Number one, who did the navigation, who did the steering? Did you all stay up all night?
We took turns steering. We had an automatic steerage too, so we didn't have to be at the wheel every minute.
Oh, I see.
Thank you, Kitty. We're going down to Tom.
Yeah, number three, what language do they speak in Bali?
Balinese.
Did you learn the language?
A little bit.
And number two, that is quite a bit of togetherness. Did you have any real arguments out at sea?
Yes, we fought every now and then. My husband's friend picked up a girlfriend in Samoa, a girl he had gone to school with many years ago. And as you know, three's a crowd and four worked out very well. So it was perfect.
Very good. All in that center hall at night. And number one, I presume you ate raw fish? I mean, you know, in 2 years.
My husband did. I never did.
Oh, you didn't?
No.
Oh, well, then you couldn't answer what I was going to ask. I'll ask it of number three. Do all raw fish taste alike?
No.
Number two, what is your best...
Thank you, Tom. Peggy Cass.
Number two, if you were in Cape Town, then you must have been coming back this way, right?
We're going west, yes.
Okay, so as you, where was your next landfall after Cape Town?
My favorite, St. Helena.
And from St. Helena, then what was your next landfall?
We went to Bahia and then through Panama Canal, Galapagos, and back up to San Diego.
Number three, did you ever hit Trinidad?
No.
Thank you. Number one, who did the plumbing on the boat when you built the boat?
I installed the head.
You installed the head yourself.
Yeah.
Did it work all the way over?
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad.
Thank goodness.
That's nice. Number two, did you do all the cooking?
I did most of it, yes. But
Now, number three, were you good in math at school?
No.
But then how did you navigate?
Well, I helped.
Did you ever navigate? Okay, number one, how were your watches split up?
8 hours.
8 hours, and then somebody else took the 8 hours, and then...
We did, and then we had an 8 hour off unless we were in a storm or a problem.
Thank you. Did you ever just set the sail, you know, just ride out and, you know, I don't know how you say it. Nobody was on, you just drifted around.
Oh, yeah.
There goes the bell, and that means no more questions, and it's probably just well. Let's mark our ballots, and we mark them for number one, or number two, or number three. Bill Cullen, we're going to start you out on this one. You're having trouble making up your mind.
Yeah.
I don't blame you. Very good imposters.
They were all good and all told very good stories. I don't know. I sort of, by a process of elimination, I finally came to rest on number three. Well, I guessed number three anyway. In any event, she was more reticent with her answers, and I think maybe she's the real one.
So we got a three, Sean. And Kitty?
Well, I went with number two. If I had to go on a trip like that, which heaven forbid, I would go with number two.
All right, you got a two and a three, and Tom Kennedy coming out.
Yeah, number two is my choice, though, Gary. Not only because she had the answers. What are you doing? Don't let me influence you. Not only because she had the right answers, but she has that robust look. She looked like an outdoors woman.
She looks like a seagull?
Yeah.
Okay, we got... Now, wait a minute now. What do we got here? We got a 1-3 and a pair of twos, and Peggy...
I feel very strongly that it's number one.
That's one?
What did you do? Did you change your mind there?
Well, it was sort of a five,
and you decided to put down a one,
right.
Huh? All right. You feel certain about that?
I feel very strongly that it's one. I don't know why, but it came to me.
In a vision, sort of.
Yes.
All by yourself.
I believe that she put that John in.
You believe?
That's right.
She's a headhunter.
She put the head in. I know she put the head in.
Okay.
Okay.
You're out there by yourself.
If you're a girl traveling on a boat with two fellas, you do that work.
All right. Boats are all in. Who better to pick out Maida Barthol than her husband and her partner in this adventure, Clark Barthol? Clark, come out and show us which one is really Maida. Here's Clark. He'll surely remember because, you know, 3 years on a small boat, he's got to find it there. Well, son of a... Well... be back to see you in just a minute. Just, Peggy, let me get back to you.
It was three.
Just on a hunch, who did you have originally?
Three.
You had three, and you changed your mind.
She said she didn't go to Trinidad, and I thought I read something about this voyage once that they did put into Trinidad, that you made the landfall from St. Helena to Trinidad. Well, then why'd you say you didn't go to Trinidad?
She was busy putting the head in.
Right.
I mean, why did you tell me that?
Well,
she did.
In fact, we did not stop.
You just, but you made
we passed Trinidad. Okay. It was inside.
Okay, let's find out who the rest of us are. Number one, what is your real name? What do you do?
My name is Jan Delahaye, and I'm a photographer.
Hey, Jan, thank you for being here. And number two, what is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Laura Walker, and I teach backgammon.
And very few people are lost overboard in that game. There are 8 million questions I want to ask you, Barthols, but the time is up. Thank you all very, very much for being with us. I have nothing fancy to say, except we got to get off of here. In the words of Buckminster Fuller, I have seen the future, and it is there. See you.
This is Bill Winkle speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Bud Cookson, Bill Cotton production.